Welcome back, geologists. This is Professor Rood, and I am going to start video 2 for chapter 11 on earthquakes. Today we're going to look at different types of seismic waves. The actual recording obtained from a seismograph is called the seismogram. And the seismogram has recorded on it different types of waves. The two main types of seismic waves are called body waves and surface waves. Let's start with our body waves. They travel, as the word implies, through the Earth's surface. Two types of body waves, primary or P waves, travel like sound waves, like a slinky, where you get areas of compression and then areas of lower pressure areas. And they can actually go through any type of material, solid, liquid, gas. Secondary waves are another type of body wave, and they are shearing waves. You can envision tying a string to, let's say, a door handle and shaking the string up and down, and that would simulate an S or secondary wave. Secondary waves can only travel through solid materials. That means that when a secondary wave hits the Earth's outer core, which is liquid, it is stopped. It cannot travel through the liquid outer core. Finally, surface waves travel around the outside of the Earth. A good representation of P waves is the slinky. So at rest, then it compresses, and then stretches. So the particle motion in a P wave moves back and forth in the direction that the wave propagates. Here is an S wave. Tie a string to a fixed point, shake it up and down, so the particle motion is vertical, up and down, perpendicular to wave direction. Please keep in mind that waves transmit energy only. There is no permanent shift in the particles they're moving through. Here I want to take a look at three different seismographs. We'll start with seismograph 1. This is the seismogram. This is the seismograph. That's the machine that's recording it at this point here. On the seismogram, the first wave to get recorded is the P wave. In other words, it's moving the fastest, followed by the secondary or S wave, and then finally the surface wave. This is the location where the earthquake originated, the hypocenter or focus. Let's go down now to seismograph 2. And what you notice is that the amplitude or height of the wave are getting less because we're further from where the earthquake occurred. We're at a greater distance. Your surface wave is traveling along the outside of Earth, along the surface of the Earth. And then finally, our third seismograph, our recording station here, you get a P wave. And the S and surface wave haven't even arrived yet because they're slower moving and not enough time has passed. Let's talk a little bit more about surface waves. Sorry about that. Generally two directions of motion, up and down and side to side. And it's the side to side motion of surface waves that cause the greatest destruction. So one particular type of surface wave that is shown in this first picture is like a rolling ocean wave. It moves in an orbital motion, wave direction going this way. So if you think of these surface waves, they're actually they have up and down and side to side motion in this example. Now in this second surface wave, you see that the ground is moving side to side. This can be quite damaging to building foundations. But these are both surface waves traveling around the outside of the Earth. Let's take a look at body and surface waves in a little more detail. P waves, those are the slinky waves, as I call them, compressional waves. They are moving the fastest and have the lowest amplitude. The greater the amplitude of a seismic wave, the more energy it's carrying, and therefore the potential for more damage. S waves, move a little bit slower than the P wave, so they're the second to get recorded at the seismic recording station, at the seismograph. And finally, surface waves have to go around the outside of the Earth, so they move the slowest. They do have the highest amplitude, meaning higher energy, and cause the greatest property damage. Here's a picture of a seismogram. And what I want to point out is the first wave here is the P wave. And then each one of these lines represents 1 minute of time. And this is going to become important when we talk about how to calculate the position or the origination of an earthquake. It is based on the arrival of the S wave as compared to the P wave. So the time interval between those two is a better way to say it. So we have 1 minute, well, the arrival of the P wave starts here. So 1 minute, two, three, four. So there's a 5 minute gap between the P and S wave. And that's very important to know when you're calculating the location of an earthquake. Let's talk a little bit more then about locating an epicenter of an earthquake. It was developed by using seismograms from earthquakes whose epicenters could be easily found. And from that, travel time graphs were constructed. I'll show you a travel time graph in a moment. By using these graphs and a method called the triangulation method, we can locate the epicenter of an earthquake. So what's important to know? The time interval between the first arrival of the P wave and the first arrival of the S wave. I mentioned that previously. From that, you find a location on the graph where the vertical separation between curves is equal to that time interval. And when I say graph, I'm referring to the travel time graph. You simply read the distance to the epicenter off of that graph, and then you need data from two more seismic locations. That's where the triangulation problem comes in. So in order to accurately define the location of an epicenter, you need data from three different locations. Let's look at an example of this triangulation problem. Here we have a seismogram from New York, and here is your P wave, here's your S wave. Our S minus P wave interval, we simply count the time, 1 minute, 2 minute, 3 minute, 4 minute, 5 minutes. So in this seismogram A, there's a 5 minute period of time that we refer to as the S minus P wave interval. In seismogram B, Nome, Alaska, let's count the P minus S wave. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, about 6.5 minutes. Oh, no, I'm sorry. That was not correct. Let's start that again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, a little over 11 minutes. Let's say 11.25 minutes. And then finally here in seismogram C, Mexico City, we have an interval of between S and P wave arrival of 1, 2, 3, and it looks like about 4 minutes. I want to go back to the seismogram B before I move on because there's a mistake on this. This first S wave, this purple box here, should be pointing right here. This is our surface wave. So the time interval then for Nome is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.5 minutes as I originally stated. So this is incorrect. This is your S wave here. So I'm going to take my P minus S wave interval for the first example, New York. It was a 5 minute time interval. So I measure 5 minutes of time between these two curves, and this is the P wave curve and the S wave curve. So we can see that if we start here, we go 1 minute, 2 minute, 3, 4, 5. I might move it over just a little, but that's pretty close. We simply then, this is represents 5 minutes of time, so we project directly down here to this scale, and we see that the distance then is 32, 4, 6, about 3,700 kilometers from the epicenter. So now what do? Then we take a compass. we put the point of the compass where the recording station was in New York, and we measure using this scale down here 3,700 kilometers, and we draw a circle all the way around New York. You go through that same process for Nome and Mexico City, and it is where these three circles intersect that is the epicenter of the earthquake. So the distance then between from Nome would be calculated to be 4,400 kilometers, and from Mexico City 2,900 kilometers. So we use our compass and draw our circles around it. Well, I think that's enough for earthquakes for this video. Our next video will be video 3, and I'm going to talk about different types of scales to measure the size of an earthquake. So this concludes video 2, chapter 11, earthquakes.